Guys, well, apparently I was talking to a session that was not live. I'm so sorry. This is my first time doing this. We are waiting for a few more people to show up here, but it's 5:03. First things first, you guys should be able to talk in the chat section. Can you guys just check in and let me know that you can hear me okay? Awesome. Cool. Okay, great. So I'm going to turn my camera on. You guys should be able to now both see me, hear me, as well as see the presentation. We're at 38 people. We actually had over 100 people sign up. I have no idea how that happened, to be honest. We only paid for a 50-group program. So I'm going to give it just another minute or two here, and then we'll get started. If you guys actually could sound off in the chat room here and just tell me what rescue that you either currently fostering for or you plan on fostering for. It'd just be nice to kind of see who's here and who's from what. I stay on my pack. Awesome. Live love. Cool. Pause for life. Very good. Nice. Manhattan. Hey, Lauren. HIT. Cool. Kansas City. Awesome. Ah, good to see some Ohio people in there. That's wonderful. Toronto. Very cool. Somewhere in LA. I know where you are, Jonathan. Charlotte. Wow. Awesome. Bowling Green. Hollywood Huskies. Very cool. Pittsburgh. I have a wonderful training reference for you, Carly. Debbie McMullen. She's actually, one of her links is going to be in the website, and she has a wonderful, wonderful training regiment. Sacramento Shelter Pets Alive. Very cool. Awesome. Cool. Awesome. So look, we're at 40. Not quite everyone who signed up, but we are recording this. So if anybody misses it, they can catch up. So we're just going to go ahead. We're going to get started here. I don't really have a set end time. This is free. I was thinking of doing it for about an hour. I really haven't put a ton of time into this presentation. It's just that I started to get a few phone calls as more fosters were stepping up in and around the LA area. And some of the questions that I was being asked to help with were kind of what I would consider more basic things. And I mean, no offense by that at all, just things that I normally wouldn't spend my time on, but I'm happy to do it. And since there's so many fosters who have limited or no experience because they're brand new right now, I just thought it would be more helpful to sit here, put out some of this information in a group format where it's recorded rather than doing it a couple times a night as new fosters are figuring things out. So very quickly, my name is Stefan. I have a dog training business here north of LA called Save Them Dog Training. We also have a rescue called the Underdog Alliance. We focus primarily on behavior cases, on dogs who are showing reactive behavior, either because of the shelter environment or not. We never know until we pull it out. That's something we'll talk about. But we focus a lot on that. In terms of education, we teach a safety course to law enforcement officers on non-lethal ways to stop a charging dog, options besides shooting them. And so because of that, we talk a lot about dog body language and how to read what a dog is saying with their body before they're actually reacting. And I'll teach you guys some of that stuff as well. We also do a dog bite prevention class for children. And some of that stuff is stuff that you might think would be kind of like normal common sense stuff, if you will. But some of the mistakes that are made when children meet dogs are some of the same mistakes that we inadvertently make when we meet dogs. So we'll go over some of that stuff as well. If you guys have any questions during this whole process, we do have a moderator. Can you comment in there? You don't? Yes, you can. Yes, maybe no. Can you see the people talking though? Okay, well, we do have a moderator. She can't do everything she's supposed to on her end, but she can see the questions. There's Katie. Katie is our moderator. So if you have questions as we're talking, put them in there. If I have time to address them and pause what we're doing to discuss your particular questions, I will. If not, we'll try and get to them at the end. If I still don't, we'll put it in an email. So here are some of the topics that we're going to talk about. Actually, Katie, can you come over here real quick? Do you know how to make this go away? Right there?
That would get rid of your PowerPoint. So you want that.
I want that. Okay. Okay. So we are going to talk. Oh, there it goes away if I don't touch it for a while. Basically, the topics are understanding your new house guest, how stress impacts behavior. We joke here on the ranch that I'm more of a dog therapist than a dog trainer. I'm going to throw a few quotes, a few thoughts at you guys as we're talking. One of my most important thoughts that I try and get all my clients to understand is a quote from Dr. Ian Dunbar. I want you to write his name down. If you're not familiar with him, you really should be. Dr. Dunbar says, if you can change the way a dog feels on the inside, many times that can impact the behavior on the outside. A lot of times when people hire a trainer or they see dog behavior issues, their first thought is, how do I stop the behavior? And my first question is, how does the dog feel right now? And if we can think about it from that perspective first, then a lot of the other behavior we see when the dog isn't feeling well, we don't necessarily see, or it's not as severe once we take care of the therapy, if you will. So how stress impacts behavior. We're gonna go over a breakdown of dog training concepts. I'm not gonna overwhelm you with this. The joke when it comes to dog trainers is if you put two dog trainers in a room together, the only thing they're gonna agree on is what the third dog trainer is doing wrong. There's a lot of arguing, there's a lot of semantics. I'm just gonna go over some basics. Why some methods work better with certain dogs, why other methods may not work as well. It's not to have a big argument about dog training methodologies, but it is just helpful information. Once we know the basics, we're gonna get into, or the concepts rather, we're gonna get into crate training, house training, loose leash walking, some basic common shelter-related behavior problems, things where if you've never pulled a dog from the shelter, if you've never taken a dog that is in a heightened state of distress, into your home environment, you may not have ever seen these behaviors. It may look severe. It may totally freak you out. But if we talk about it now, you might be able to understand how some of this behavior that might be really freaking you out is actually pretty common. And if we can stick with it for a few weeks and understand it, we're going to see a different dog. Talking about introducing our foster dog to our resident dogs. Most people that foster have another dog in the house. I want to be very clear right now. This is not a course to help you if you're having aggression problems. If you're having problems with your dogs integrating, if there's fights, if there's bites, you need to contact your rescue right away. You need to get a qualified trainer out right away. You don't fix aggression and fights with a webinar. Honestly, this is more basic information. But we still want to talk about the proper steps. Introducing your foster to the outside world, and then what to do if you're struggling, as well as some helpful links and resources. All right. So first thing is we have to understand stress. There are two types of stress. Typically, we say a dog is stressed out. The technical correct term is distress. Eustress, E-U-S-T-R-E-S-S, is a good, healthy form of stress. Distress is the bad form of stress. Every dog, every person, everyone here watching this webinar has a stress threshold. It is this imaginary space in between my fingers. As life hits us with different things that bother us and that upset us that we have to kind of internalize, our threshold gets lower and lower and lower. And stress is cumulative. Stress builds over time. Reducing stress also takes time. We're not going to see an immediate shift in behavior if we have a highly distressed dog. But as stress accumulates, and the threshold gets smaller and smaller and smaller, it takes less and less and less for our dog to go over threshold. Over threshold is a term we use when the dog is reacting. This is when your dog is doing the thing, whatever the thing is. They're lunging, they're growling, they're barking, they're trying to bite. They've already gone over threshold. At that point, we've kind of missed our opportunity to have a positive, learnable, trainable, teachable moment. And so if we take a dog from a shelter and they're walking into our house with a threshold this big, and we're focusing on training first before we focus on therapy, we're only giving ourselves this much room to work with before our dog lunges on leash, or before our dog reacts to the new dog, or before our dog reacts to a sudden sound or a sudden noise or the UPS guy or any other unknown variable that we can't control. So the most important thing we want to do is we want to help our dog have a big, healthy threshold. And if you can kind of relate to yourself as a person right now, and think back to that time in your life when you were the most stressed out. Everything was going wrong. Maybe it's right now because you're quarantined in your house and your kids are driving you nuts. And every day they're bugging you and bugging you and bugging you and bugging you. And your threshold is this big. When something happens and you finally go over threshold, when someone cuts you off in traffic and brake checks you, when one little thing happens, we call that the straw that breaks the camel's back. The straw is not necessarily so heavy. It's all of the other straw that the camel already has on its back, correct? That's the analogy. That's the stress threshold concept. It's not so much what happens to us in that moment when we go over threshold that is the most important thing to consider. It's everything we're carrying into that situation that makes it so hard for us to go through that and make the proper choices. Same thing with dogs, even more so because they lack the ability to reason and talk them out of a situation and go, okay, I'm really stressed out. I should just take a deep breath. They can't do that. They need us to do that for them and help them take those deep breaths. So the first thing I want you to do when you bring a dog in is I want you to lower your expectations. To be totally honest, if you've adopted a dog before and they gave you no behavior problems, amazing. Many dogs don't. If you've never adopted a dog before, if you purchased from a breeder, whatever your history is, if you've never had a dog, I don't care. Just lower your expectations because you're taking a dog who has a high level of stress and no relationship with you whatsoever, and you're bringing them into a brand new environment. So give them time. There's going to be mistakes. Things are going to happen. That's okay. If we go into it expecting some things to happen, then we tend to kind of give our dogs a little bit more time. And honestly, if we can give time for that relationship to build, all relationships take time. Every relationship you've ever been in, and usually the best relationships that you've ever been in, have taken some work at some point. So with that thought in mind and applying that basic principle to our new foster dog, give things time. We have a kind of a 3-day, 3-week, 3-month kind of loose guideline, if you will. You may have heard about it on social media. You may understand it. You may not understand it. The way I interpret the 3-day, 3-week, and 3-month guideline is that it takes about 3 days for your dog to even understand who you are, that you're this new provider of good things, that you're this new person that's going to do this awesome reward-based training with them, and you're going to provide them the structure and the stability that they most likely have lacked in their past environment, in their past life. It takes 3 days before they even know who you are. So we shouldn't be asking for a whole lot in those first 3 days in terms of expectations from them. And we shouldn't be demanding too much. We shouldn't be taking them out. We shouldn't be going to dog beaches and dog bars and dog bar mitzvahs and all the dog things that people love to do. This is LA. People love to do everything with the dog. And that's amazing. I love people that have dogs who are happy and love to be outside doing things. That's awesome. But if your dog isn't ready for it, your brand new dog isn't ready for it, give them time. So 3 days, 3 days before they know who you are. 3 weeks where we are building some practices, where we are controlling resources, not because we're the dominant alpha or any nonsense like that. We'll talk about dog training later. We're controlling resources because these dogs don't know what choices to make, and we want to set them up to succeed. So the more resources that we control and that we give to them in exchange for the behavior we want, the more we set the stage up the right way from the beginning. We set them up for success with clear expectations. One of the biggest problems that people do is they humanize dogs. They feel sorry for dogs. They pity dogs. We see this like rescue syndrome, if you will, where we feel bad because this dog had a horrible life. We see the pictures. I ran shelters for years. For 6 years, I was a shelter director. I walked past all the cages every single day. For 3 years after that, I was an animal cruelty investigator. I cut dogs off of chains. And I saw them in these pitiful states of mind. And it is so hard and so counterintuitive not to just shower them with love and shower them with affection and shower them with all of these wonderful things, just laissez-faire, just free, just because life has sucked for you. And now I want life to be good for you. And that's a common thought. But if you, once we get a little further into the slideshow, you'll understand, excuse me, why that thought process and having no rules and no structure and all of that freedom and all of the feeling sorry for them and pitying them, what that can really do is give us a dog who resource guards. It can give us a dog who has an unhealthy attachment to us that is so codependent on us that they have massive separation anxiety when we leave because we haven't desensitized them to the process of us just coming and going. And every time we see them, we make such a huge deal out of it that we're actually stressing them out in the process. So we don't want to anthropomorphize dogs. We don't want to humanize dogs. We want to empathize with what they've been through, but we want to give them this guideline, this structure. And then once we get to the 3-month period, at that point, between 3 weeks and 3 months, we are giving dogs more freedom. Maybe we leave a couple more toys out, lower value toys, and see how the dogs in the house share them. Maybe we leave the dogs unsupervised for 5 or 10 minutes at a time and just sit outside the door and hang out in the yard or hang out in the car with a camera app so we can see what they're doing for 5 minutes before we leave for an hour or before we go to a picnic and leave and come back and there's some kind of disaster. So we go through that 3-day, 3-week, and then 3-month guideline. If you get past the 3-month period and you've gone slow, you generally have a dog who's pretty well in line with the rules. They know what the guidelines are. They know the boundaries. They know the structure. Everything has been positive, and they're pretty well settled in. Last thing to think about when it comes to dog behavior is what was once known is generally, for us, unknown when it comes to dogs. We don't know what they're coming into our house with. If they come from a shelter, they generally come either as a stray from the animal control officer, so they were found on the streets. Why were they on the streets? We have no idea. We can speculate all we want. We can see a scratch on their nose and assume they were a bait dog. And all that is just speculation and generally untrue, by the way, about bait dogs. Most of them, honestly, sadly, do not make it out of the environment that they're in. But we don't know what they're carrying from the past. We don't know if they have gone through certain periods that were traumatic, that's going to cause some sudden explosive response that makes no sense to us. Also, whatever they did know in the past could very well be forgotten. One of the quickest things that is forgotten is how to be house trained, how to be potty trained. A dog in a kennel is usually in a 4x8 or a 5x10 type of structure, and they typically go to the bathroom whenever they need to go to the bathroom. Some dogs in shelters are awesome, and they will hold it all day until some amazing volunteer walks them, but a lot of them get used to just relieving themselves whenever they need to relieve themselves. So that dog that comes in your house and poops in your carpet in the first few minutes, it doesn't mean they've never been house trained. It just means that, well, maybe they haven't, we don't know, or maybe they haven't, they've forgotten, which is why the structure and why the boundaries and why going slow just makes things so much easier for everyone to kind of get together and get on the same page quickly. So this is basically a visual kind of representation of stress. We have this little ladder here, and what this is showing here is at the very beginning here is we meet our foster dog. They have a very small threshold. They can't handle a whole lot, so we shouldn't be doing a whole lot. Just give them what they can handle. As we take our foster dog home, we go into this decompression phase. While we decompress, it's a lot of management, it's a lot of rules, but it's a lot of positivity. They start to relax. They get more time out than they did before. The environment is generally much quieter. They start to settle in, and their threshold gets bigger and bigger. At this point, if we are giving management and structure, and we're controlling resources that they might have a hard time sharing initially, we're not just dumping a whole bunch of stuff there with their new siblings and hoping things go well, that management and structure actually reduces stress. If we give them free rein and give them all the toys they want and free food and no structure and they can't handle that, that's going to decrease their threshold. That's going to give you a more stressed out dog. So the way to get to one big happy family with a nice big threshold is to give them that management and that structure in the beginning. Okay, so again, my joke is if you put two dog trainers in a room together, the only thing they're going to agree on is what the third dog trainer is doing wrong. There are all kinds of ideas about the right and the wrong way to train a dog. My basic take-home thought for you is you should always do what is least stressful for your dog. That's my take-home message. No matter what particular method you apply, whatever what particular command you try and use, what particular tool you try and put on your dog, you should always be reading their emotional well-being, and you should be pointing towards the least stressful option. If I were to, just for sake of conversation here, simplify dog training, there are two basic camps as far as I see things. You guys can debate until you're blue in the face. As far as I see it, there are two basic camps, and I started in one camp, and then I progressed to the second camp. So the first camp waits for the dog to show behavior that we don't like, we don't want them to see, and then they give a quick, sharp correction to teach the dog through consequences that that behavior is unwanted or unwarranted. There's a lot of kind of terminology you can put around that, but the basic thought process is wait for the dog to do something, and then give them a correction. The other type of training involves not waiting for the dog to do something, but rather reading their signs, reading their cues. And if they're uncomfortable in a situation, if they're thinking about doing something, redirecting them back to us, which requires some training first and foremost, redirecting them back to us, asking them for alternate behavior instead of the other thing that they wanted to do, rewarding them for the alternate behavior, and then they make these positive associations. So those are, I'm very much simplifying reward-based training versus correction-based training. You have some trainers who like to call themselves balance trainers. I don't want to confuse you, but for sake of argument, those are trainers who use multiple methods and multiple ways to work with dogs. So my dad taught me how to train using corrections years ago. It was all choke chains, shock collars. It was, you know, it wasn't loose leash walking. It was a perfect heel, because if the dog's nose went past my knee, that meant the dog was trying to walk me and I was supposed to be the one walking the dog. So I had to pop the chain and teach them that I was the one in charge. A lot of this training stems from a study of wolves, a wolf sanctuary down in the 50s. And we'll send some links here in a little bit. Actually, you can probably put it in the comments. The Whole Dog Journal, Debunking the Alpha Theory. So Katie's going to drop a link that you can read later. And so the basic, you know, short end of the story, the quick way to tell the story is they studied wolves years ago. And it wasn't a natural wolf pack. It was an unnatural wolf pack. It was a sanctuary. They watched how these wolves handled conflict. Based on how these wolves handled conflict, they then decided that if this is how wolves maintain order in the pack, this is how we must maintain order in our home. Kind of a simplified thought process. They weren't trying to do things the wrong way. That was just how they understood the data, how they understood the information. So the book that was published, the book that was published is called The Wolf. You can find it online. The author of The Wolf has asked his book to no longer be printed, and the publishers still print it. Why do you ask? He no longer wants his book to be printed. He realizes that he misinterpreted the data. He misinterpreted the information. Scientists, actual scientists who have way more education than most dog trainers, no longer use the term alpha. What they use is the term breeding pair. Why does that matter? You could call it semantics. You could say, I'm just trying to argue like most dog trainers. It matters to me because when I think of the word alpha, and maybe you think of it in a different way, but when I think of the word alpha, I think of this state of constant conflict where we're always trying, or where the wolves are always trying to show that they are in charge. Otherwise, an up-and-coming wolf might decide to take that position over. The reason why scientists no longer use the term alpha when studying wolves is that we've learned that a true wolf pack is actually a family. It's a father and a mother and their litter. That is an actual pack. And when I think about our relationship with dogs, I think about it in the same way. I think of it as an actual family. They're not my human children by any means, but what I mean by family is it's not a constant state of conflict. I'm not beating them into submission. I'm guiding them. I'm leading them. But it's all through benevolent leadership. It's through guiding them to make the right choices that I want them to make. And it's avoiding or stopping them preemptively from making bad choices in the first place, choices that I know they can't handle. My son's 13. He would love to drive my car. I'm not going to let him right now. He's not ready for that. Okay. He's not ready. It's my responsibility not to just go, hey, do what you want. You really want to drive that car, go out and see what happens. But we do that with dogs. So we got to stop that. So this Whole Dog Journal, if you're interested more in debunking the alpha dog theory, and if you can get past the fact that maybe you use the term alpha and you mean it differently, just look at that. It's important because it kind of determines how we set the stage for behavior that we either want to stop or not allow in the first place. If we look at all inappropriate behavior as our dog trying to exert dominance over us or be the alpha, then we are going to be in this constant state of conflict and we're going to be relying on corrections. And if you correct your dog, the best case scenario with a correction is that your dog suppresses the behavior because of the force, fear, or pain that you've interjected into the situation. Just because they've suppressed the behavior, it doesn't mean that they feel any differently about the situation itself. We want our dogs to feel good about people. We want our dogs to feel good about dogs. We want our dogs to think positive thoughts and have positive associations. So if I can take a shock collar and zap a dog, or an e-collar or a stim collar or whatever makes you feel comfortable calling it, if I can use one of those tools that uses some sort of positive punishment to stop behavior, or I can use rewards to ask the dog for different behavior and reward the different behavior, I'm gonna go with the rewards, because science has taught us that is how animals learn the best, it's how they learn the quickest, and it's how the information sticks in long term. We're not gonna talk too much about aggression right now, but very briefly, when we discuss aggression, there are 7 identified forms of aggression. Only one of the 7 identified forms of aggression is not rooted in fear. Most aggression is rooted in fear. So let's say your dog is leash reactive because they're afraid of new dogs. Why are they afraid? We don't know. This is a new dog. We don't know why they're afraid. All we know is they have this explosive fear-based response to new dogs. So let's say instead of the dog, we kind of table that analogy and we put you in the situation. Let's say you are afraid of spiders. You're so afraid of spiders that every time you see one, you lunge, you scream, you throw a shoe at it, you try to kill the spider because you are so deathly afraid of what it may possibly do to you. So what do? Your significant other is embarrassed. They hire me. I come over. I put a newspaper in their hand, or I give them a baseball bat, or I put a shot collar or a squirt bottle or all kinds of things. And I say, listen, every time they scream or shriek or react to a spider, I want you to hit them. Hit him as hard as you can, hit him as quickly as you can. If your significant other does that to you and they're consistent and they hit you hard enough and they hit you quick enough, you're gonna learn pretty soon through association that if you see a spider and they're around, you better not do anything because you don't wanna get hit. But do you ever feel differently about the spider itself? And the answer to that is clearly no. Of course you don't feel differently. If anything, you have more negative associations with the spider itself. So that's why we have to go towards reward-based training. That's why we have to stay in this quadrant of dog training as much as humanly possible. And no, we can't always stay in positive reinforcement. And anyone who says that they stay only in positive reinforcement, I quickly question how they handle a dog who jumps up at a door, because what I've been taught to do is negative punishment. Negative punishment means we turn around. Negative meaning we take something away. We turn around. We ignore the behavior, that's the punishment. And when the dog gives us the behavior we want, we then apply the positive reinforcement. So you can't possibly stay just in one quadrant, but the longest that we can stay in positive reinforcement and the longest that we can use high value rewards to help shape different responses, the longer we're actually gonna help the dog feel differently about whatever it is that is triggering them, just like you and the spider, if you'll go ahead and accept that analogy, if you will. So that's why it matters. That's why we use rewards versus corrections. So this is one of my favorite pictures to show people. These are some wolves. I am very, very fortunate that I get a chance to work with wolves with the Warriors and Wolves program up at the Lockwood Animal Rescue Center. I've been there for over 2 years, ever since I came to California. I help handle the wolves. I help teach the new veterans there about animal behavior and about how to use high-value rewards to lure undomesticated wolves and to get the behavior we want from these animals who are not domesticated. And I use this picture because I hear a lot of things when I talk about treat training and reward-based training. I hear that we're tricking the dog. I hear that dogs aren't food motivated. I hear lots of different ideas that really and truly are not rooted in science. If you look at the science behind reward-based training, and if you look at the science behind utilizing food as one of those rewards, and I say one of those rewards because it should not be the only reward. We have other types of rewards. We can use balls, we can use toys, we can use affection. And what we're supposed to do is we're supposed to use food in conjunction with some kind of verbal marker so that we can eventually pull the food out of the situation. We shouldn't rely on food the entire time we're working with a dog, but it is the best way typically for many dogs, no blanket statements, no generalizations, no absolutes, but for many dogs, it is the quickest and best way to bridge a gap between the behavior you're seeing and the behavior that you want. Why is that true? Well, if you look back to that very first wolf and that very first dog that hung out together, I promise you, no one was there. There's no FaceTime videos of it or anything, but I promise you, that very first wolf and that very first dog, or human, excuse me, did not hang out together because the human alpha rolled them. The human didn't show the wolf who was boss. We were dropping food. That's always been the link. We've always been dropping food and they've always been picking up on that. That's how the relationship started. So to completely discount it kind of blows my mind, to be honest. But when we look at the science behind food and when we go back to this thought process about stress and the stress threshold, the stress hormone in our brains is cortisol. When cortisol is pumping through our brains, we do not make good choices. Nobody makes good choices when cortisol is pumping through our brains. So let's say you have a new foster dog and they're super stressed out and they're making a really bad decision and you yell and scream and they freeze and shut down. You may have stopped what was happening, but do you think there is more or less cortisol in your dog's brain at that point? If the answer is more, you are correct. And if there's more cortisol, if we are increasing stress, that means we're doing the wrong thing. We should always be guiding towards decreasing stress. The beauty of food is twofold, is particularly when we talk about stress. Food is a metric of stress. If we have different valuations of rewards, so we have low value rewards, which could be kibble, boring milk bones, things of that nature. We have mid-value rewards, which are your training treats typically at pet stores. And then we have high-value rewards. That's your human-grade food. That's string cheese and hot dogs and pepperoni slices and Braunschweiger and anchovies and all the disgusting, smelly things that your dog is going to lose its mind over. When we bring those highest value rewards possible, again, liver paste, not milk bones, okay? Anchovies, not kibble. When we bring those things out and our dog won't respond to them, we know that that's a very good indicator that our dog is pretty stressed out in the situation, even if they haven't reacted yet. And too many times, like I said in the beginning, we wait for the dog to react and then go, well, what do I do now? Don't wait for the dog to react and then ask what to do. Evaluate their stress. Read their stress, read what they're saying. I promise you, a dog that won't take liver paste or anchovies from you, even if they're not growling or barking, they're pretty uncomfortable. That doesn't mean food isn't working. That means your dog is too stressed out for that situation. You should read that. You should hear that. You should understand and respect that and wait a little bit. It means your dog isn't ready. The other beauty too, utilizing high value rewards and going towards a reward based system with dog training, is that we are decreasing the cortisol by adding feel good hormones. You can't get this with corrections. You simply cannot. You can't correct a dog and make them happy all of a sudden. So when we eat food though, we know scientifically what happens when that food touches our tongue, goes into our mouth, and our brain realizes what's happening. Our body starts to produce dopamines and endorphins. Those happy chemicals start to be pumped into our brain. When happy chemicals are pumped into a stressed out brain, it reduces the stress. You cannot be as stressed out as you were the moment before you ate your favorite meal. It makes you happier. So if we are talking about dog behavior and fostering a new dog in terms of stress and therapy first, yes, give lots of high value rewards. Not for nothing. We want them to work for it. We want them to give us behavior for it, but we should be overloading them with all of these different things because it really does help them break out of their shell, reduce the cortisol, increase the dopamines, increase the endorphins. And then you get a dog who listens to you, not because they fear the consequence. They listen to you because they are in eager anticipation of the reward. Going back to Dr. Ian Dunbar, again, one of my favorite resources and Katie's least favorite quote, all training is a matter of negotiation, whether you're training dogs or whether you're training spouses. I want you to think about that. All training is a matter of negotiation, whether you're training dogs or whether you're training your spouse. If you want behavior, and you want to be a benevolent leader, you're going to give something up in exchange for what you want. That's what training comes down to for me. It's therapy first and then negotiations next. Therapy, then negotiation, therapy, then negotiation. And then I have a dog who wants to listen to me. They want to listen to me, not because I'm the alpha and I'm going to beat them into submission. They want to listen to me, like I said, because they are eagerly in anticipation of what's going to come next. Training should be fun. Fostering should be fun. Yes, there's going to be headaches. They're going to poop on the carpet right away. They're going to do things that are going to stress you out. You're going to have to get up a little bit earlier and exercise them a little bit more in the beginning because they have all this extra stress. There's going to be extra work involved, but it should be fun at the end of the day. Training, fostering, decompressing, all that really should be fun. And I don't see how it can be fun if all we're doing is correcting them and suppressing behavior because we want to show them who's boss. So that is my little spiel on dog training. I'm not going to go any further into it. We're now going to get into some of these questions that I have been fielding the past week or so as brand new fosters have popped up. Again, we're dealing with dogs that have unknowns. I always tell my clients, dogs do not know right from wrong. They have no morals. That's why we have to spay and neuter. If they had morals, we wouldn't have to spay and neuter every dog. They are amoral. However, they do know good and bad. They identify things in the world as good and they want to approach it. They want more of it. Or they identify something as bad and they want to get away from it, and fight and flight kicks in at that point. Good and bad. That's how they see the world. So we want to help our dogs see things as good as much as possible, right? Not bad. That's another reason why we lean towards reward-based training. But that first starts with a dog who is food motivated. And when we free feed, and you look at feeding schedules, my first point there, when we free feed and we give our dogs access to food whenever they want, they have no need, they have no reason, and they typically have no desire to then work for the food. So free feeding is highly discouraged. Putting your dog on a feeding schedule is definitely recommended. There are two ways to do it. What is recommended by most trainers, by most veterinarians, by most people in general, is twice a day. You feed in the morning, you feed at the end of the day. And based on your dog's size and all that, the type of food you're using, that amount is going to vary. Some dogs that come in from the shelter are highly stressed out. They can't keep weight on. Maybe they have to be fed smaller amounts 3 or 4 times a day because they're going to eat too quickly, too soon. We have concerns with stomachs bloating, things of that nature. But free feeding is what we want to avoid. We want to have dogs who see these resources going down in sufficient quantity. We see them being picked up in sufficient quantity. And then when we bring our treat bag out, they know it's time to train and they're more motivated to do that. They're more motivated to listen. They're more food motivated in general. Having a feeding schedule also means that we don't have to worry if we have multiple dogs in the house with dogs fighting over food bowls. You may have never experienced this before. If you've had dogs that have not come from unknown histories and unknown pasts, you may have had dogs who have been given ample quantities of all of the resources that they've needed during their earlier formative developmental periods. Dogs who have had ample quantities of food and water and treats and toys and bones and all those things early on typically don't mind sharing those things. Why? It's always been there. It's always been an ample supply. Dogs that come from backyard breeding situations, dogs that come from terrible owners, dogs that come from abuse situations, dogs that come from neglect situations, or even dogs that had all that stuff and then wound up in the shelter for a while where they no longer have it. If there is not an ample supply of resources, and anything can be a resource, even you petting your dog, loving on them, giving them attention, giving them all those things we naturally want to give them, if there hasn't been an ample supply of that in the past, and all of a sudden we just dump it on them, and there's other dogs around, it might be hard for them to share those resources. They have to have time to learn that there's ample supply. So that's another reason why we want to go on a feeding schedule. Going on a feeding schedule is going to, when getting your foster, I'll stop and read the question. When getting your foster on a feeding schedule, is there a certain amount of time you should leave the food available before picking it up? That's a very good question. I typically give them 10, 15 minutes. That's typically long enough for them to eat their food and then pick it up. And if they miss some food, you're going to do some reward-based training, first of all. So throughout the day, they should be getting some more nutrition. And then at the end of the day, they typically will eat more. And some dogs can go a couple of days without eating the food. Yes, Lauren. So some dogs can go a couple of days without eating food. There's two thoughts here. You always want to be careful of your dogs. You don't want them to go too long without eating food. If your dog skips one day and the next day they're super hungry, great. One day is not going to hurt too much. If they're not, though, you might want to stimulate their appetite. There's things that we can do. Again, we always want to think of higher value things. Think of everything as a negotiation. If the kibble, the dry food, is not valuable enough and they're too stressed out to eat it, if their stress level is here and the food has this level of a value, they might not eat it. They might drop weight to a dangerous point. So if we up the value of the food, then, and the food is then more valuable than their level of stress, they will start to eat. So we can put a little bit of wet food in there and put wet food just in with the dry food. Tablespoon, even half and half if you want. What we do a lot, because we're in California, we go to In-N-Out a lot of times. There's one couple minutes away. We get dog patties with no salt, and we'll just crumble the dog patties up and mix them with their food. So some human grade food, some wet food, you know, things of those nature, things of that nature, can help them just want to eat more and can stimulate their appetite. So hopefully that's helpful. 10, 15 minutes, pick it up and try and give them some higher value items. Just make it a little more interesting. And when it comes to that, just kind of an overall rule of thumb. If you are walking your dog and they're least reactive, if you want them to not be least reactive, you have to be more interesting. If they're not eating their food because they're too stressed out, you got to make the food more interesting. We always have to find ways to be, it's not about being dominant. It's about being smarter than our dogs. So we can always find ways to engage them in a way that they want to engage back with us. Everything should kind of be a bit of a game. So feeding a schedule goes straight to crate training. I'll read your question next, Katie. I'll let Katie read your question, Katie. I'm going to get on to crate training and house training really quickly, then we'll circle back around to that. So crate training and house training. A lot of people have problems with crates. Crates, any tool, honestly, any tool can be used the right or the wrong way. Crates are not a form of punishment. Crates are not where they go to be disciplined. But a crate should be a safe, den-like area where if we are not in a position to watch our new foster dog and know what they're getting into or not getting into, or just to help with the overall house training, which we'll talk about in a little bit, or if our foster dog wants to enjoy things like bones and bully sticks and Kongs without the stress of sharing them with the resident dog, or if we just want to have our dog comfortable being in a crate because we're going to be gone for too long of a period to leave them out, which is important in the beginning, we can put the food in the crate. But crate training is very important. Crate training, we're not going to get into muzzle training because that's more of a higher level thing, but any kind of tool that we use, whether it's a crate, whether it's a muzzle, no matter what it is, we always want a dog to have a positive association, but a properly crate trained dog shouldn't be destroying the crate. They shouldn't be showing severe separation anxiety when you leave them. They should be comfortable in the crate. They should be happy in the crate. So the way we make our dog comfortable in the crate, the way we make our dog happy in the crate, is that we use these tools when we don't need to. One of the biggest mistakes is we don't put our dogs in crates until we have to leave. So now we leave the dogs. Let's say we aren't on quarantine or lockdown and you foster a dog on a Friday, you go back to work on Monday. So dogs had Friday afternoon, Saturday, Sunday with you. Everything is great. Everything is awesome. Now you have to go to work. You can't trust them because they don't know the rules. You put them in a crate. All of a sudden you leave, they're in the crate. You leaving is stressful. Them being in the crate is going to be stressful. All we've done is we've doubled down on the stress. So we have to use these tools and get our dogs accustomed to these tools, not when we need to use them, but before we need to use them. That's how we create the positive association. So for crate training, typically what we will do is, first of all, we'll reinforce the crate. I think that every crate should come with zip ties and carabiner clips. They should just be sold as a package deal. If you have a wire crate, grab some zip ties. Every area where there's a corner where your dog can nose through it and make a little bit of room, zip tie it. Rule of thumb here, I want you to remember this. Dogs generally will do what works and they won't do what doesn't work. So if they can push at the end of a crate and at the corner of a crate and it pushes and it gives a little bit, they're going to keep pushing and they're going to keep pushing and they're going to keep pushing. They can push to the point that they harm themselves. They can push to the point that they, cut their noses and where they can, eventually break out. At that point, you can have dog fights. You can have damage to furniture. You can have all kinds of problems. And in the meantime, while they're doing all this, what are they doing? They're getting more stressed out and more stressed out and more stressed out. So you have maybe two dogs who get along great, but you want to crate them while you're gone for a little bit just to make sure, which we recommend. As you leave, you didn't crate train your dog. You didn't desensitize them to crate training. They freak out. By the time they get out of that crate, there is a potential that both dogs are so stressed out by that whole experience that a dog fight happens that wouldn't otherwise happen. Not because of aggression, because of stress. So that's why we have to reinforce crates and crate train. So a lot of times,
what's up, buddy? You come on through. You're fine. Come on through.
He's just thinking. Okay. So a lot of times what we do is we put our food bowls in the crate. We don't shut the door. We just put the food in there. We never want to force dogs. So typically if the food's in there, they're going to go in there. If there's treats in there, they're going to walk in there. And if we can, if it's possible and we're home, this is the way we should be doing it, we just leave the door open. We don't force it on them. We just let them walk in, eat their food, and walk out. Walk in, grab the treat, walk out. Once they're comfortable with the in and out process of the crate and they like the crate and they view it as a comfortable place, then we can start to put them in it. And again, while we're actually home and for short intervals of time, They say that a training session can last between 2 to 5 minutes. Crate training and muscle training should also follow those guidelines. Put them in for a minute or two, let them out. Put them back in for a minute or two, let them out. Put them back in for 5 minutes, let them out. You always want them to be calm. You always want them to be happy. Can I do feeding schedule and crate? Yes. So we actually recommend, I'll get back to you, Katie, too. I didn't want to forget your question, but we actually recommend that you combine the feeding schedule with the crate training. Because food is typically such a primary motivator for them. They can eat their food in their crate. It can also, if you do decide to shut the door, depending upon your lifestyle, if you have kids running around, if you have 5 extra dogs, whatever the case may be, if you're still working on house training, you can crate them while they eat, close the door, do whatever you have to do without worrying about the dog having an accident. And then after 5 minutes or 10 minutes of their stomachs digesting the food, you take them right out on leash. You go outside, we'll get into house training next, and you help them relieve themselves. So all of these kind of actually go together. If you have a feeding schedule and you use your feeding schedule in conjunction with crate training to make it a safe, positive place, and we use crate training in conjunction with managing our dog and making sure that they, second they're out of their crate, it's straight outside for potty training, all of these things can kind of flow together and become a whole lot easier for us. Katie, let me read your question. Our foster is not quite house trained. Her doggy door at the rescue, so she just went out when she needed. Now she doesn't know how to ask when she needs to go. We've been taking her out when we take her other dog, but his bladder must be stronger because she had action still. So this is something, Katie, where, and you'll have to let me know, follow up with this if you want to here. We can have a little interactive session. When she has some accidents, is it like right after she drinks water? Is it right after she plays really hard? Can you predict when these moments happen? Because if you can, what we can do is kind of go a little bit backwards with this, give her some time outside. And real quickly with the house training, what we do is we bring the food, we bring the rewards with us outside in the yard. You have, again, as a rule of thumb here, you have a half a second to reward behavior for them to make the correlation. So if you send your dog out in the yard and they go to the bathroom and they rush back in and you give them a treat from the treat jar, you've just rewarded them for coming back in the house, which is amazing. You want your dog to want to come back inside. Okay, gotcha. that's frustrating. You want them to want to come back inside, but if you want to reward the house training, then you have to go out with the food in hand, with the leash in hand. You want to pick one spot in the yard. Don't walk around. I have some dogs that will walk for two, and chime in if you have this. I have dogs that will walk 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 blocks. You can walk them for an hour and they won't go to the bathroom on their walk. Why? I don't know. They just haven't before. They weren't allowed to, whatever the case may be. I see some fosters getting so frustrated, just walking and walking and walking, waiting for the dog to do something. If you just stand in one spot, and if you've ever had dogs before, or if you live in like an apartment complex or a place where you see dogs regularly relieving themselves, go to that area, that scent will kick in. And then what we do is we just simply stand like a tree. We don't look at the dog. We don't talk to the dog. We don't distract the dog. We just let them sniff. We let them smell. We let them do all those things that they have to do until they feel like going to the bathroom. And the half a second after they go to the bathroom, we want to double and triple down on that praise. We want to make it a big deal. I don't care what your neighbors think. You shouldn't care what your neighbors think. Make all the noises. Get excited. Again, if you want your dog to learn something, be quick and be super, super, super engaging with them when you want to reinforce, like, hey, this is what I want you to do. And that's going to help a lot with crate training. Nisha, hopefully I pronounced that correctly. How can you tell if he's peeing to mark or really done relieving himself? That's hard. Okay, you're very welcome. That's hard to tell if they're really done relieving themselves, especially with male dogs. Good, wonderful. I'm very sensitive to that, so I'm glad I did. Especially with male dogs who have been neutered later on in life, they tend to be markers. They can mark a lot, so it can be hard to tell. Katie, for instance, has a male dog, and he will mark literally every spot he can. He's just pretending at the end of the walk. Nothing is coming out, but he's still trying. So just kind of watch them, see if a little dribble's coming out or not, just kind of gauging on that. But typically we just sit there, we ignore them, we make a big deal out of the act of going to the bathroom, and then we can stay outside, play with them, engage with them, run around, have some fun, let them drink water, see if they'll go to the bathroom a second time after they've drank water. And if you're still struggling with random potty accidents, this is where we have to, for the beginning, go back to the crate. This is where people cringe. This is where people say, I don't want my dog to go in the crate. But we cannot help our dog after they've done something. If your dog goes to the bathroom on the carpet while you're at work and you come home and you rub your nose in it, all you're doing is teaching your dog that you're a jerk. That's all you're doing. We have that 0.5 second window. So unless we're following our dog around the house, giving him a verbal correction within 0.5 seconds, we have to manage their environment a little bit better. So if you are home and you're having random bathroom problems and random potty problems, again, go back to the crate. And we're going to talk about ways to make crates even more interesting, more exciting, more fun, giving them things to do. We're going to talk about mental stimulation and mental enrichment while they're in a crate. They shouldn't be bored. It shouldn't be a bad place. It should be a fun place. They should have things to do in there. But if you go back and forth and every time they leave the crate, they go outside first, they're on leash, and you wait for them to go to the bathroom and then do whatever you have to do. And then when you are unsure of what they're going to do, you put them back in the crate and give them something to do. Even if it's for 10, 15 minutes, then right outside and into the bathroom again. The more consistent you are with this, the more it's going to click in very, very quickly. So let me see. I have a couple of questions here. Christine, 3-pound puppy. Ooh, what kind of puppy? I'm just curious. 3-pound puppy who has grown up out of humane society. So when you say puppy, I'm just going to ask you really quickly, how old do you mean by puppy? First time she said anything other than concrete. Poor thing. I'm not sure how much she's been outside, but clearly she's terrified. Should I try to potty train on pee pads inside first to associate go potty? And when she's comfortable, work up to go in my backyard. She's had one more round of shots, so I can't walk around on a leash. I live in the city, but I have a small backyard. 3-month chihuahua mix. Aw. Okay, so you're thinking the right way. A lot of dog trainers, and I will be the first one to tell you this, a lot of times we're guessing. We may have been doing this for 13 years, 15 years, 20 years, 100 years. I don't know how long that would be or how that would be possible, but we're always guessing. So always go back to whatever you hear from me, whatever you've heard from 10 other trainers, think back to, is this going to increase the stress or decrease the stress? So your idea is, because she's terrified of everything and she is less stressful in the house, to start the behavior where she is less stressed out, reward that behavior then and there, and then move to the outside. And that is incredibly smart, Christine. That's fabulous thinking. You're thinking the right way. As the stress level goes up for a dog, the likelihood that they're going to be able to listen to you or do anything at all decreases. As the stress level goes down, the likelihood that they can listen to you or do anything at all increases. So Christine, if you always, and like you just said, use the word go potty inside the house where she's less stressed out, and you use those potty pads because she's going to respond to you there, and you double, triple, quadruple down on the praise. As you see the stress go down overall, and as she gets more comfortable going outside, you can then move those pee pads outside. Repeat the process a couple of times with the pee pads. If it's working, you can try and remove the pee pads completely and then go from there. So great thought, great suggestion. I'm really loving the input here, because I'm sure what some of you guys are thinking or asking, I guarantee you somebody else that's watching this or somebody else who is going to watch the recorded version later is also probably thinking about. So fantastic job. Shannon, my foster keeps only peeing on all of our patio furniture. How do we establish a specific potty spot? Should we leash him in the backyard to guide him to one place until he goes? Instead of leashing, Shannon, if you can, if you have the time, if you can be patient, just go out there with them. Even if you have to stand out there for a while. Some of the things we do for dogs in the beginning, if we go slower, even if it takes 20 minutes or so, if we go slower and we're just patient and we're physically right there to reinforce the behavior, it's going to click so much quicker. So if you're able to, if you have the time, just stand in one spot. And that's why sometimes combining crate training with feeding is so valuable. You can put them in their crate, give them some food. If you have to, if you're trying to simulate, you know, going to the bathroom, throw something in there that's a little fattier, something that might make them have to go to the bathroom a little bit sooner. Give them 5 or 10 minutes to digest it in their crate, and then guide them outside when they're more prompted by their stomach to have to relieve themselves. You might get that behavior quicker. Again, it's not about being the dominant one. It's about being the smarter one. Mary, 2 senior fosters, excuse me, they aren't having a hard time peeing. That's good. He found that spot quickly. But they aren't regular with pooping. They're eating twice a day. But should I be concerned? They aren't having accidents inside. Eating twice a day, but they're not having accidents inside. They're not regular with pooping. So, Mary, would you say they're going more than 24 hours without any kind of bowel movements? And what I'll say is I wait for you to respond once a day each. Okay. You're very welcome, Shannon. I always recommend, I always err on the side of caution when it comes to medical, especially with seniors or unknown dogs. If you are ever concerned about any kind of behavior, always know there might be a medical reason for that behavior. You know, it's always possible a dog can have an intestinal blockage. Would both dogs have intestinal blockage? Probably not. But is it possible? Sure, anything is possible. So, you know, I personally, I have a lot of anxiety. It's just a lifelong issue. I've always had it. I always will have it. So I understand these dogs because I know that they have a lot of anxiety as well. If what you're seeing is concerning you, by all means, talk to your rescue, see if you can schedule a vet check. But some dogs just poop once a day and that's all they do. Especially too, if you're feeding a really high quality food. Oh, thank you. Losing daylight. If you're feeding high quality food, that's going to mean possibly less poops, more firm, more compact poops. So I wouldn't worry too much. You're not having accidents on the inside once a day is good. Things should be coming in, things should be going out. But Mary, I wouldn't recommend against going in and having a vet check just to make sure there's nothing else. They can feel in there and they can just answer that question. If anything, just to give you some peace of mind. Catherine, currently feeding my dog in his crate. When do I know he's ready to be fed outside of his crate? Excuse me. Is there a time frame limit or amount of time comfortably in there to know I can start feeding outside of it? Catherine, I'm going to ask you a question very quickly. Is this the only dog you have in the house, or do you have other dogs in the house? Once you answer that question, I'll go ahead and respond. Oops. Okay. Generally, how much language can a dog understand, words versus tone? We had an 11-month German Shepherd Husky mix. Ooh, Lauren, we should talk more. People think we have all pit bulls here. We have more German Shepherd and Huskies than we have bully breeds right now, to be honest. Dogs are incredibly intelligent. Tone matters a lot. The words matter a lot. I always tell my clients, if you think back to the old Charlie Brown comic strips, if you remember when Charlie Brown was talking to the teacher, what did Charlie Brown hear as the teacher was talking? Womp, 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 womp. That's what dogs hear as we're talking. That's my belief, at least, is that dogs are hearing this womp, 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 womp. So if we want to get into their heads, if we want to redirect them from certain behavior before they do it, if we want to make associations, if we want to teach them commands, not only the word, but the tone matters as well. That's why a clicker can be an invaluable tool for the whole family to use, because clickers always sound the same. They make the same noise. They're always used the same way. But I would say that if I remember correctly, the smartest border collie learned like over 100 words, if I remember correctly, in the Guinness Book of World Records. So they can learn a lot, but it's not just the word, but the tone as well. So Catherine, you have a cat. Okay, so do you see, Catherine, let me talk to you very quickly about dog and cats, because species integration can be tricky, can be interesting. Are they integrating? Are they interacting? Do they play together? Do they have a relationship? Do they have a bond? Last question. How long have you been fostering these guys? Dominic, should we put their water bowls in the crate or outside the crate? This is a question, Dominic, based more on how long they're in the crate. If we're leaving and we have dogs that are being crates for more than an hour or so at a time, they should have some access to water. If we're trying to teach them to not go to the bathroom in the crate, and they're just going to be in for short intervals and then out to go outside and then back in for short intervals and then back outside, I wouldn't put water in, just because they're only going to be in there for a very short interval. And we're trying to teach them that all those things in terms of going to the bathroom happens outside. But if we're leaving or it's any kind of extended period, they have water bowls that clip onto crates. They have water bowls that are like those, like guinea pig or gerbil or hamster feeders, so they don't knock their water over, make a huge mess, and they can just kind of lick it as they need it, because they definitely do. Access to water is super important. Obviously, access to water is more important and more critical throughout the day than access to food. So that's kind of Dominique, hopefully I said that correctly. That's more a question of length of time in their crate, and then I would base the answer on that. In general, do some new foster dogs hold their stool for like a 2 days before pooping a lot? So if you guys know Chesty, if you guys seen me on Instagram and you follow me on Instagram or Facebook, you know that I have a wonderful dog who comes with me for my police training. His name is Chesty. Chesty and I will go to a city for a town for 2 or 3 days at a time. Chesty and I are used to this routine. Chesty's done this for a while. Every time we go, Chesty protests pooping. Doesn't matter where I take him. I can take him to a dog park. I can walk him around all day. I can feed him tons of high-value food. He protests taking a poop until day three. I couldn't tell you why. He just doesn't – I mean, I can tell you why. He doesn't feel comfortable. But for some reason, even though he is 8 years old and we've been doing this for years, that's just kind of his go-to. He's just not going to poop for a couple of days. So, yes, some dogs, if they're not uncomfortable, if they're stressed out, they can't hold their stool for a couple of days. Honestly, if you get past day three, I would definitely talk to a veterinarian, see what they would recommend in terms of from a medical standpoint. One thing that my lawyer likes to remind me of is that I am not a veterinarian. My lawyer likes to remind me that all the time, and trainers should not be giving out medical advice in general. That's what veterinarians are for. Veterinarians, on the other hand, shouldn't be giving out training advice because that's what trainers are for. And a lot of times we kind of jump into each other's wheelhouse once in a while. So I don't want to answer too many medical questions, except as food is coming in, it should generally be going out. And if that's not happening after a couple of days, I would talk to your rescue about a vet check just to make sure and err on the side of caution that there's nothing medical. Because again, if we know there's something medical, we check that out, we know there's no intestinal blockage or anything, then yes, if it takes a couple of days, we have to do a few things to stimulate a good poop. That's okay. It's not too uncommon. Okay, so my cat 2 years, fostered my dogs for 2 days. They had a few civil encounters, no hissing, biting, or scratching, isn't lunging. Okay, and I wouldn't leave them alone either, Catherine. So again, we have a 3 day, 3 week, 3 month kind of guideline. I wouldn't feed outside of the crate until we're past the first 3 week mark. And a lot of that is not necessarily because we're seeing problems. We want the problems to go away. It comes back to relationship building. Everything comes back to relationship building. If you are eating at your favorite restaurant and some random stranger or the waiter just decides to sit down and eat at your food, at your table, you're probably going to have a problem with it. Even if the waiter was kind of nice and they took your order, you're not going to be okay with them taking your food, right? But if you're eating dinner and all of a sudden a family member sits down and they start eating off your plate, I get mixed comments here. Some people say they would still deck them, but most people would be more tolerant of the family member eating out of their food bowl, eating out of their plate at dinner versus the stranger. So with that thought process in mind, in terms of giving dogs time to build relationships, not because there's a problem, but because we don't want there to be a problem once we do add other sorts of things like food, I would give it that 3 week guideline and give them time to have lots of interactions. Last question for you, Catherine, does your cat have his or her claws, his claws? Okay, Katrina. Yes. Okay, good. I love cats that have their claws. They're very good instructors when dogs get a little too inquisitive. So that's good. That's helpful. Okay. Karina, how do I properly introduce dogs to confidence cats and skittish cats in general? We're going to talk in a few slides specifically about dog integration tips. So we'll get into that once we get past the basics. You're very welcome, Catherine. Very welcome. So the last thing we'll talk about here as we've gone through feeding schedule, crate training, house training, is setting up the proper flow in your house. If you have multiple species, multiple dogs, if you have dogs and kids, if you have just different variables, I see you, Sophia, I'll answer that question. If you have different variables to consider, you want to look at flow. It's a very good idea to have a few areas in your house where you have some secure baby gates. Some dogs can bulldoze straight through those pressure mounted baby gates. I would recommend taking the couple of extra minutes to get the ones that screw in if you can, but have some baby gates. If you have dogs and cats together, have baby gates with a little cat door. If you have dogs and cats also, since I know we have some in here, at least one, if we have dogs and cats, make sure we have lots of vertical spaces for our cat to get out of the area. You know, that prey mode can kick in with certain dogs, and we may not see it right away. And then a cat runs down the hallway, and all of a sudden instinct kicks in. Giving them lots of vertical spaces just increases the safety. And also cats see the world in terms of vertical space versus horizontal space. So you make their world bigger anyways. But give avenues so there's proper flow. If we have an outdoor potty area and we have dogs that can't be together yet, make sure there's a way for one dog to go out without rushing right into the other dog. Put them in an area where we can kind of crate and rotate, if you've heard that term before. We have to give these dogs some time to get accustomed, to get adjusted. Again, 3 days, really nothing should be happening day one through day three. They know nothing. You're a stranger. They're in a strange house. Everyone around them is strange, and their life was just strange before that. So they got a threshold that's this big. Give them more to work with before you test them out with situations. Sophia, just got my foster day, 6-year-old pit mix. How long should I wait till I give her a bath? In terms of physical contact, we're going to talk about dog-human introductions. I have a kind of rule of thumb. Most trainers have a rule of thumb where you want to kind of make sure the dog is comfortable with anything you do before you go further. So as we're touching them, some dogs love touch. Some dogs you can bathe right away because they're so happy to be touched. Touch a dog for a couple of seconds. We say 3 seconds and then stop. What do? Do they rush up for more? 3 seconds and stop. Do they rush up for more? Cool. Guide them over to the tub. Toss some treats in the tub. Do they recoil? Maybe they've had a bad experience of being bathed. Take it easy. Toss the treats in the tub. Do they jump in there because they love treats and they have no preconceived notion of the bath? Well, cool. Now we can turn the water on. How do they respond to that? Take everything with baby steps. Just kind of ease them into every situation. So you might be able to bathe her right away, Sophia, if she's totally fine with all that. If she recoils, if she's uneasy, if she's unsure, they do have some pretty decent cleaning wipes that you can get. They have some dog shampoo that is a spray that you just comb out. So they have some less stressful, less intrusive ways to get some of that shelter funk off of them, if you will, if she's not comfortable with that. But that's what I would try. Always ease dogs into something. The most ornate tricks, if you guys have ever watched agility shows and those competitions and stuff, those dogs that can do all those amazing, ornate, advanced tricks that all started with something basic and then growing and then growing and then growing. So slowly guide them into each new situation and then read them. What are they telling you? And they'll tell you if it's too soon or not. Yes, first 3 days, it's really okay to be in one room only. We want to go for the least stressful option. We don't want to flood them. So many times we do too much too soon with the dog, then there's an incident. And at that point, that's usually when the rescues call me and the dog comes here. After an incident, the dog is going to stay here for longer. You're making life more difficult for the rescue and more difficult for the dog if you jump into something before they're ready and there's some kind of reactivity moment. There's something that shuts them down or causes them to go over the threshold. Like, guys, okay, I'm fine right now. Thank you. Yes, it really is. First 3 days, it's okay. Again, least stressful option is always the best option. I have some people that live like right where, you know, they go outside, the dog is so terrified and the dog just shuts down the second they go outside. So I say, look, if you have to pick your dog up, put them in the car and go for a drive somewhere where walks can be fun, then pick your dog up, put them for a drive, put them in the car, give them a drive somewhere and go somewhere where walks are fun. Everything should be fun. We shouldn't be butting heads and fighting with our dogs. But that may mean we have to think about creative solutions. If this is not fun, if this is scary, what can I do to get what I want out of the dog, but make it fun for them? And the more we do that in the beginning, even if it's extra work, the easier everything else becomes down the road. You're very, very welcome. Good. And if she loves belly rubs, she might be great for a bath. Again, if she recoils at the bath, if she shows you anything weird, just look up the cleaning solutions. Actually, you can probably find them on Amazon. The deodorizing and cleaning wipes. And then you can do that for a couple of days until she's more comfortable with it. All right. So now we're going to get into some more advanced concepts. We're going to get into some more actual training. Some of this is a little higher level. I'm not going to expect you to remember all of this. We have provided links at the end of the slideshow that Katie is going to, as I start talking about topics, Katie is going to start dumping these things in. One of the first tools I want to talk about is clicker training. I'm not sure if anyone's ever tried clicker training, if you've ever heard of clicker training. A lot of trainers say, I don't need a clicker. I'm too good for the clicker. I don't need that. Drop your ego, first of all. Clickers are great. The reason why clickers are great is because the clicker is a consistent sound. It's a tool that fits on your finger. It has a little like strap that fits right on your finger. It makes a noise that is the same all the time. Our dogs need consistency. We don't want them to hear what Charlie Brown heard when his teacher was talking. We want to get through the womp, 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 womp. So the whole point of a clicker is to mark the behavior that you want to see. So when I'm working with dogs, what we typically have is we have a command. We're going to talk about recall training next. So our recall training is the watch command. So I'll say watch, and I'll have the dog pay attention to me, and I'll lure them with a high value reward. And when the dog gives me the attention that I want, I'll give them the treat, and then I will immediately click and mark the behavior. The second I want, I get the behavior I want. Not only get the treat, excuse me. The second I get the behavior that I want, I mark it. The very second, because again, I said you have a half a second, right, to get into your dog's head and make an association. So one of the trainers that I'm going to give you a link for, his name is Zach George, Z-A-K, no C in there, Zach George. Some trainers don't like him. Some trainers love him. I think he puts out very good information in a very easy to understand way. We'll give you a link here in a little bit on clicker training from Zach George. It's right there on YouTube. You can click it. Pause it. Don't watch it now. I have more stuff to say, but watch it later. The whole point, again, of the clicker is to mark the behavior we want, because we have 0.5 seconds for a dog to understand that they're doing what we want them to do. So step one with clicker training is called charging the clicker. Charging the clicker is very simple. Click, treat, click, treat, click, treat, click, treat, click, treat, click. That's it. No behavior. We're just charging it up. We're creating this association where the dog realizes that as soon as they hear that sound, that means a reward is on the way. A reward is incoming. This buys us time. If we have 0.5 seconds for our dog to make a correlation and we say sit and the dog sits and we start to fumble in our treat bag for a treat, do you think we're going to get that before or after our little 0.5 second window? It's going to be after. So maybe the dog will make the correlation, but not as good as they could have made the correlation if we could click it. And they knew that we marked the behavior, they did what we wanted in that half a second, and that buys us the time we need because they know food's incoming to go ahead and give the food. Now you can replace the clicker with other, you know, you can use verbal markers. You can say, yes, or good job, or potato, or whatever you want to say. But at the end of the day, we have to have consistency. If you have a house, if you have multiple people in the house, if everyone's working with the dog, as everyone should, the clicker is always going to sound the same. And as Zach George says, I'm stealing his line, your thumb is quicker than your tongue. While we're training, we should be having tons of repeat interactions, tons of 60 to 120 second learning moments with our dog. If we're doing that, there should be a lot of clicking. We don't want to be hoarse at the end of the day, and we don't want to slow down because we're tired of talking, as you've heard me clear my throat because I had clients to talk to all day today. You want to be quick, and the clicker is quick. So that's why it's important. It's a great way to start. Yes, you can go away from it later, but if you charge the clicker and they know that that sound means you've done the right thing, food is coming, it's going to make everything else a lot easier. So that's clicker training. Recall training. If our dog doesn't know to look back to us for guidance, how can we ever expect them to? So many times we just expect our dogs to have this connection with us, but we never take the time to build that connection. And that's kind of funny if you think about it in that context. We need time to teach our dog that when we say a certain word, and for me, it's the watch command. I never say watch, it's watch. The reason why it's watch is because I never say that word in that tone, in that context, ever, unless I want a dog to focus. Again, womp, 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 womp. I know what that means, so they can get through to us, or we can get through to them, rather. When we give them that recall command, and we pair that attention and that focus with the highest value reward possible, and we do this over and over and over again in the house, not on the leash walk when the dog is already lunging, not in that situation where the dog is already stressed out when they're going after our dog or they're hyper fixating on the cat or the bird or the kid or the mailman or whatever. That's not when we try to teach them that they should focus on us and be rewarded. We have to do it when there's no stress, when there's no distractions, when there's no triggers. This can take up to 3 days to 3 weeks for them to really understand this. That's why we have these guidelines. How can you expect to keep your dog under control out in the real world if we've never taught them in the home where things are easier and less confusing and less overwhelming, that if we say a word, they're going to get something they value very, very highly. If all training is negotiation, we kind of have to show our hand to our dogs before we go out in the real world. Before we need the behavior, we have to show them why it's a good idea for them to give us that behavior. So the watch command, some people call it look, some people call it focus. Again, you can even use the clicker. Some people use the clicker as a modified recall tool. I said the clicker is supposed to mark behavior, but some people use the clicker in a modified manner, and the clicker becomes the recall tool, and click means focus on me. I don't care what you do as long as your family is consistent, but you need to find a word that says, hey, look at me. Don't look over there. I'm going to reward you. This is how we get alternate behavior. And this is also how we make positive associations. If our dog is thinking of lunging, if they're thinking of barking, if they're thinking of doing anything, and we haven't taught them alternate behavior and a reward for that, we're just kind of left fumbling around and yanking on dogs and yelling at them and squirting them and doing all kinds of archaic things that really doesn't help them learn. So we've done the clicker training. We've done the recall training. Our dog knows that there's a word that says, hey, focus back on me. Now we want to learn and practice loose leash walking. Before we go into loose leash walking, I want to put a thought in your head. I think it's actually in the next slideshow. It's the benefit and the importance of physical and mental stimulation. When I was in Ohio years ago, I used to work for rescues. And if a dog would fail a dog-on-dog assessment, they would ask me to come over with my dog, Bullwinkle. We would try and get a different read on the dog, because a lot of times the shelter helper dogs just weren't that reliable. We would try and get a different read on the dog. And if I could get Bullwinkle and this dog to show any kind of positive interactions, somebody would take that dog and the dog wouldn't die. And I knew going in as a former shelter director that these dogs were wound up. So this is why I started bringing my skateboard, and we were out in the country. So I'd have dogs just pull me. And I had this app on my phone, and some of these dogs were running 4.5 minute miles. Let that sink in. 4.5 minute miles. On mile two, they were slowing down to like six and a half minute mile. Point being with that is a lot of these dogs are coming into our homes with a lot of excess built up physical needs, not just physical, but mental as well. Many times we treat our leash walk as exercise. If you treat your leash walk as exercise and you also want your dog to loose leash walk, you're kind of having some unrealistic expectations. If you are struggling with loose leash walking, but your dog is a better leash walker at the end of the walk than the beginning of the walk, it's because your dog is tired finally. So what we want to do, if we want to incorporate and practice and create and shape this behavior and this expectation that walks are supposed to be polite and loose. And again, I don't care about a perfect heel. I want my dogs to sniff the proverbial and the literal and figurative roses. I want them to have that mental engagement, that nose work. That's great for them. It wears them out, it tires them out. Nose work is great. Yanking and pulling and pulling us down and all that stuff, that's not great. That's not what we need. So if you're thinking of leash walk as the way to exercise your dog, you're always going to struggle with them walking loosely until you get to the end of the walk. If you start with some physical stimulation, and maybe you live in an apartment and you have to be smart about this, but if you find ways to get that initial energy out of your dog first, that's going to help. That's the physical part. If you combine the physical with mental and slow your dog down, because what I didn't realize in Ohio was sometimes I would wear dogs out physically and their brain was racing even faster than when I started, and that made their behavior even worse. So we have to tire their bodies out, but we have to slow their brains down. If we can't slow their brains down, they're going to have a hard time focusing. They're going to have a hard time listening to us. So we wear them out physically. And then, just like when we were in school, if we had a nice teacher before a big test, we always had a practice test. So the way I slow my dogs down after physical stimulation is we just practice our recall training. We practice our watch commands. We slow it down. We bring our clicker out. We bring our rewards out. And we just practice that behavior. Then we slowly start to go on our leash walk. Now, when it comes to the leash walk, again, dogs will do what works. They won't do what doesn't work. So you can have a dog on a leash and a collar, and they can choke themselves out on that walk. And as long as you guys are still moving forward, as uncomfortable as it is, it's still working in their mind. we don't want to punish them. We don't want to yank on them. We don't want to do anything like that. What we want to do is simply stop the walk. The second the dog pulls, we stop walking. And then our recall training comes into place. Hey, look at me instead. Watch me. They sit, they slow down, they focus, they get a reward, and we slowly walk again. And every time they pull, we stop. And if we're consistent and we're not rushing through this because we have to get to the office or rushing through this because we have to make dinner or take kids to sports activities, if we're really treating our walk as a training session and we're consistent, they will learn pretty quickly that pulling intention means the walk stops. And sitting by, walking loosely by your side, not only means that the walk continues, but every time they look back at you, they get rewarded. This is why the watch command is simply an exercise where they give you focus and attention. They don't physically have to sit for you. We just want eye contact. My dogs can do the watch command in stride while walking. The dog that is coming back to you for rewards consistently during the walk is a dog that is naturally loose leash walking, not because you have a gigantic prong collar on them and they fear the punishment. They're doing it because you are interesting, you are engaging, it's a positive experience, they're being rewarded for it. That's why they're doing it. But again, we have to kind of set them up for success and not treat our leash walk as how we exercise our dogs. Handle that first, make the leash walk training. If you do that for the first 3 weeks, you will create some expectations of behavior. You will see that your dog starts to naturally walk loosely on the leash without a workout session ahead of time. And then your walks can be longer because they're nice and they're you're not being dragged down the street. You can have more walks where it's physically and mentally engaging and stimulating. But for now, exercise them physically and with their brain first. Make the walk a slow training session. Real quick before I read your question, Christine, the last thing is recommended walking equipment. What I recommend are no-pull harnesses. If you ever have heard someone say to never hire a trainer if they recommend a harness, they probably don't understand the difference between a back-clipping harness and a no-pull harness. If you look at sled dogs, all of those dogs wear harnesses and they clip on the back. Those harnesses promote pulling. So if you have a harness that clips at the back and you want to pick up skateboarding, great, you have the perfect harness for it. That's going to promote more pulling. If you have a dog and you want them to stop pulling, you need to have, that's a good question, Lauren. You need to have some no-pull options. So my two favorite no-pull options, the first one is called the harness lead. I like the harness lead because I have 50 dogs on the ranch and I can have one harness lead fit every dog on the ranch, basically. So it's a one size fits all. The other reason why I like the harness lead is it is escape proof. Some harnesses, like the Easy Walk harness, is actually not escape proof. If you just clip it on the chest, they can get their little front paws up and through. And once they get up and through with their front paws, there is literally nothing holding them into that harness and they are gone. And Chesty taught me that at the waterfall, at the edge of a waterfall on a hiking trip once. So I like the harness lead because they are 100% escape proof. The other reason why I like the harness lead is it is just one tool. There's nothing to clip onto something else. If you have a strong dog and you're in an unexpected situation and they pull and there's some equipment malfunction and a buckle or a clip becomes detached, all of a sudden you have a loose dog. So for lots of reasons, I'm a really big fan of the harness lead. It also constricts around the chest versus around the neck and throat, which is a pretty sensitive area for dogs. So I'm not sure why people are so focused on applying so much pressure to such a sensitive area. Another good recommended walking equipment for dogs is the Freedom No Pull Harness. If the harness lead is not enough for you, if they're still pulling, let me know. I'll buy your harness lead off of you. It's not a waste, but get the Freedom No Pull Harness. It is basically the Cadillac of harnesses. It has a martingale type of clip to the back, so it provides that chest constriction as well as a clip on the front. So you get the front no-pull benefits as well as the chest kind of no-pull martingale benefits as well. They're about $45, $50 or so. Harness lead, I think, is around $29, $30. Freedom no-pull leash harness by 2 Hounds. Yep. Yeah, uh-huh. Okay. Yeah. And then the last one is going to be the, that's the bulk of recommended walking equipment. Let me go up real quickly before this question goes away and I can't see it. Christine, not leash training, but leash related question. When I had my previous dog, we had puppy classes. We were taught the tethering technique in conjunction with edible chews. I haven't had my foster long, but she's very opposed to the whole thing when I tried yesterday. I never used it as a punishment, more like time for the dog to self-entertain / tethered while we eat, as to promote no begging for food. So Christine, this could be a tool where for some dogs in some situations it works. Other dogs, we remember, yes, gentle leader. The other dogs, thank you. Can you go ahead and get a link for the gentle leader? Other dogs, if they have maybe, have some kind of traumatic experience in the past and they're really aversive to it, always go with the what is causing the least amount of stress for my dog. If I've learned something from a trainer and now it's causing more stress, what else can I do instead? That's again why crate training can be very beneficial. If their crate is a good place for them, it's a happy place, it's a safe place, they can't beg for food while they're in their crate. So that can be another reason for that or another possible option for you to try. How many leash training walks a day versus exercise runs versus potty walks? It's going to be an individual answer there, Lauren. That's going to be kind of up to you and your dog. Typically here on the ranch, though, we're on a 2-hour schedule. Every 2 hours, they're doing something, whether they are exercising, whether we're practicing leash skills, or whether we're having just a potty exercise. It's basically a 2-hour rotation for us. So if you guys are all home because of what's going on right now in the quarantine, I would try to do something with them on those regards every 2 hours if possible. And then there's the gentle leader. Yes, so the gentle leader is another option. The only reason why I don't use gentle leaders too much is because I do a lot of muzzle conditioning. But again, you guys shouldn't be worried about muzzles, and a gentle leader is a fantastic, fantastic tool. Gives you a lot of control. Lauren, I think my crate question fell off the crack. Sorry about that. We got a crate yesterday, put it in the guest room, slept in the room with her with the crate door open, and she was stressed out when I stepped out. Then she relaxed with the crate. How long before she'll be okay to sleep there alone? It's hard to say, Lauren. I'm going to give you some ideas in a little bit about ways to further decrease the stress in your home. But what I want you to do, and what I want everyone to do, is don't get – I know I gave you a 3-day, 3-week, and 3-month guideline. With that said, don't get too married on – specific time frames. Gauge it based on what your dog is telling you. If she's able to relax with the crate, with you in the crate, then just stick with that for a while. If you have to move the crate around for a little bit and you have to have her sleep next to the bed for a couple of days because she's more okay with that, then have her sleep in the crate next to the bed for a couple of days until she's more comfortable and more calm. Once we get to that 3-week mark, honestly, typically, and again, don't get married to the time, but typically at that point, if you're doing things the right way, a lot of the stress should go down. A lot of that demand barking, anxiety barking, I don't know where I am or how long I'm going to be in here barking, a lot of that fades away after the first 3 weeks. So I kind of bend over backwards for my dogs. I do what they need for the first couple of days and weeks. And if I do that long enough, then they typically are more than happy to give me what I want from them in exchange. You're very welcome. Thank you so much. I really appreciate that. So now we're going to do introductions. First and foremost, we have people, we have dogs. Very first rule, follow your rescue protocol. You probably signed some form of paperwork. You have some form of training. If anything I say goes beyond your rescue protocol is more important. Please follow that first. Second, general rule of thumb. If you are experiencing aggression, don't rely on this webinar. Please hire a trainer. I do FaceTime consults. I do discounts for lots of people. The reason why I did this webinar again was I was doing FaceTime consults for crate training. I mostly do FaceTime consults for aggression. If that's what you're experiencing, get in touch with me later. If you're not experiencing aggression and you don't have any rules or restrictions, these are general guidelines for introducing your dog to people and introducing your dog to dogs. Thinking back to this whole concept that dogs do not know right from wrong, they only know good and bad. If we are introducing our dog to some variable and we want our dog to identify that variable as something good, we don't wait for them to make up their own mind and then go, whoa, shoot, now what do I do? We introduce that known good variable ahead of time, just like we've been saying all night. We bring the food with them. We greet with a treat. So what that means is whether you're in the house or whether you're walking your dog down the street, the first thing you want to do is as your dog sees this new person that we're going to hang out with and meet and be introduced to, we get our dog's attention first. That recall command is going to be a foundation command for a lot of more advanced behavior. That's why that recall training is so important. It gives us a dog that's under control. It gives us a dog that has more impulse control because we've taught them to focus and hold that focus for longer intervals of time, which helps them settle. So we have them focus on us first. We reward them. They know that person's over there, and we always give some distance, give some space, pretend that your dog has a bubble. And as our dog is focused on us and taking rewards, if our dog is not taking the treats that they would normally take, what is that? That's a metric of stress. That means our dog is uncomfortable. So we can use this to gauge how our dog is feeling. If our dog is taking treats normally, we know our dog isn't too stressed out. So then at that point, we want to go ahead and we want to avoid the following three things. We want to avoid a lot of eye contact. I feel very sorry for people that have huskies. I feel very sorry for people that have dogs that have adorable faces and brightly colored eyes and all of these things that cause people to stare at them like they're babies. Dogs don't like it. Most dogs don't like it. Now, many dogs can be conditioned to know that looking at a human is a favor, is a good thing, but they're conditioned to know that about their owner. They're not necessarily conditioned to know that about a stranger. Yet for some reason, we are obsessed with getting in a dog's face, not respecting the space, staring at them, and then waiting for them to think or and make up their determination about whether or not we are good or we are bad. That is so stressful for a dog. Not only is the eye contact stressful, leash tension is stressful. If our dog is tugging at the leash and they want to go investigate that other thing and they're tugging on the leash and we don't have control over them, we are going to introduce one of these seven forms of aggression. One of the seven forms of aggression is called frustration elicited aggression. Your dog wants to go and explore. They want to sniff, they want to smell, or they want to get away. Either way, they want freedom of movement. We have not given them freedom of movement because we live in a society where we can't have dogs running around, so we have them on a leash. As that frustration builds, and because we haven't taught them to focus back on us and reward them for something different, which can help alleviate that frustration, as that frustration builds over time, it will eventually increase to aggression. This is the dog who seemed okay in the beginning, and the person kept staring at him and staring at him and staring at him, waiting and then reaching in to pet the dog, which is why we always wait for the dog to say hi first. And they've just been hanging out still for a while, and then all of a sudden, the dog bites. We have just put that dog through so much unnecessary stress and so much unnecessary tension. We don't have to do that. So what we do is we give the dog a bubble. We tell this person, hey, this is a brand new foster. I'm still learning about this dog. Why don't you do me a favor? And we hold our dog over here. We stretch the leash out a little bit and we have our treats over here. We say, hey, here's some treats. Can you just toss these to my dog? Why toss? Because if the dog isn't comfortable and they reach right in, well, that hand can become a target. Or if they're not comfortable and they're not sure and we reach right in, that hand can frighten them to the point that they're no longer comfortable. But we can toss the treats from, say, 3 or 4 or 5 feet away, because about how much of an arm span you should have. And if the dog will focus on the new person and take the treats from a distance, then we can gauge our dog's behavior. We can gauge their body positioning. Dogs should not be stiff. Dogs should not be still. Tails should not be stiff. Tails should not be still. Dogs should not be staring hard. If a dog is relaxed, their mouth is generally slightly open. If their mouth is stiff and their body is stiff and everything about them is stiff and their tail is wagging, they're not happy. A wagging tail does not mean a happy dog. A loose wagging tail that is down near the hock means a happy dog. A stiff wagging tail that is up and elevated means an agitated dog. So you have to know your dog. You have to know how to read dog body language and dog behavior. But if you bring high value rewards with you, if you get your dog's attention first, if you give them the rewards first because you already have recall training under your belts, and you then pass those rewards on to the new person, you can then gauge their response. You can help them make positive associations. And you can pretty much ensure that they're going to want to go up and say hi to that person. That's the next rule. May I say hi to your dog? I don't know. Does my dog want to say hi to you? I don't let anyone pet my dog. I wait for my dog to go up to them first. Now, a lot of times my dogs want to go up to somebody because they just toss them a piece of pepperoni. Like I said, dog training is science, guys, but it's not rocket science. They see something good. They see the person giving them the good thing. A lot of dogs are like, cool, awesome. You're going to give me good stuff. I like you. It really isn't that tough. Or you're going to give me good stuff. I'm not sure. I'm not going to take it. Well, then we can go, hey, you know what? I don't think my dog is feeling this. Let's just not try. Let's not go further. Let's not push it. Because when we push it and we go further, because we want to make sure that this dog likes this person, and we do too much too soon, we have a bite. Once we have a bite, we may have a dog that has to go back to the shelter. We may have a dog that has a dangerous dog designation. We may have a rescue that's getting sued because we decided we had to go further. We had to test the boundaries. So use food, give the dog a bubble. And then once they do go up and they invite the pet, give a 3-second rule. Pet, 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 stop. Does the dog stiffen and walk away? Well, then they were tolerating it, but they didn't really like it. Does the dog lean in for more? You're golden. The dog wants more. So that's people in general. Dogs, it's similar. What we want to do is, again, we want to avoid the eye contact. I think back to my first years as a shelter director and all the meet and greets I did in my parking lot. And I stood there with the dog and the adopter stood there with the dog. And we said, well, let's see how this goes. And sometimes it went well because the dogs could tolerate our stupidity. And sometimes it went just the way I kind of expect it to go when we sit there and we hold a tense leash and have dogs stare at each other. Dogs don't meet that way naturally. Dogs don't stare each other down for more than 3 to 5 seconds. If you see dogs looking at each other for more than 3 to 5 seconds, you want to kind of intervene with that and help them because that means that the stress is increasing, the frustration is increasing. I'm going to pause real quick and read this question. Karina, in regards to human body language around dogs, is it appropriate to approach their body sideways instead of straight on? I don't know if Katie can find it, but Dr. Patricia McConnell did a study on points of light. Those are good search terms. If you can find it and you can find the article, go ahead and drop it in there. I'm not sure if you can. It's not the most widely disseminated article. Short answer, Karina, yes. Shifting your body positioning to the side can be much less threatening to dogs, similar to not staring them down head on. Both of those things are less threatening. Getting down on a dog's level can be less threatening. A lot of those positions can be less threatening. The reason why I'm asking Katie to find this, I'm not sure if she can. Okay. This is a fascinating article, guys. Fascinating. Read it later. There are some theories about the way points of light hit a male frame versus the way points of light hit a female frame. Stay with me. I know it's kooky. I discounted this article when another more experienced trainer sent me. I'm like, this is ridiculous. I read it. I read it again. I read it again. I read the links. There's some stuff here that should not be discounted. So for lots of reasons, Karina, yes. In regards to human body language, always think of the positioning, the posture, the tone, and the initial approach that can be the least stressful and can be the least intimidating to dogs. Do you introduce new dogs to each other on leash or off leash? That's just what we're getting into. Perfect segue. So the first thing we do is we do a tandem walk. There's some kind of just like, it seems like confusing ideas or thoughts or rules, if you will, here. Dogs don't normally greet each other face to face. Dogs don't normally greet each other with any kind of leash tension. The way we normally greet dogs, it actually adds the stress. It increases the frustration. It makes things more likely to go wrong. I know many dogs that could meet off leash totally fine and they struggle on leash. Unfortunately, we can't just let dogs meet off leash. We can't. We don't know how. We have to have more control. We have to control the situation until we better understand what they're going to do and how they're going to respond. Now, again, as a higher level course, we can talk about muzzle conditioning and having dogs meet off leash with a muzzle. I have a few dogs where their impulse control is so bad because of what they're exposed to that they literally cannot do what we're going to talk about next, the tandem walk. They cannot do it from 100 feet away. But if I muzzle condition them and I let them meet off leash with no tension whatsoever, they can. But that's more of an advanced concept. I don't want to go into that in this webinar now. But if you want to talk about that concept later, Carly, we can. So typically it's on leash in the beginning because we have to have some control. So instead of on leash and noses pointed at each other, it's on leash and noses pointed in the same direction. Find a place where there's no triggers. Go to a park where there's no people. Go to a reservoir. Go to a wildlife preserve. Go to a baseball field that's empty. Go anywhere you can go where it's just you guys. create some space, create some distance. Just like with the introductions to people concept, giving your dog a bubble, give your dog a bubble to anything first. The more space a dog has away from a trigger, the more likely they can focus on you and actually take those rewards. The closer they are to a trigger, the less likely that they can handle that situation. So we go for a tandem walk. And the rule of thumb is be as far away as you have to be so that the dogs can still focus on you and still take the rewards. So from a distance, we're going to have food. As we get closer, the food needs to completely go away. Not in your pocket, it needs to completely be removed from the situation. You give to someone else helping you, you use all of the food so there is no more food, but food and dogs is a very dicey thing. So it's important to use food as we're creating associations. It's important to remove food as we get closer to avoid anything that they might actually fight over or have some sort of conflict over. So it's from a distance, noses forward, parallel walk, and you go as long as you need to go until the dogs are comfortable with each other. You slowly get closer and closer and closer. They should not be charging at each other. If they're charging, they're not ready. And if you can only do walks at a baseball field and you have to be 50 feet away, but that's where it works, then stay there. Always stay in the bubble where you can get the behavior you want. Even if that is a big bubble, if you stay there and you wait until the dog is ready for the bubble to get smaller and smaller and smaller, it always will get smaller. So it's from a distance, see the dog, take a reward, keep moving. See the dog, take a reward, keep moving. See the dog, take a reward, keep moving. What should happen with most dogs that don't have severe issues is within 5-10 minutes, they're walking side by side. As they're walking side by side, they're doing a little nose sniff. Maybe one goes behind, does a little butt sniff. And again, remember your 3-second rule there. Let them sniff faces for a couple seconds and just kind of gently guide them away. No correction, just kind of guide them away. So nobody has any kind of misunderstanding in the beginning. At the end of that leash walk, what I typically do is we then go into our yard. If the dogs are walking side by side with no problem, we drop the leashes, but we leave the leashes on the dogs. Bless you. We leave the leashes on the dogs. It's very, very important. You may think things are going fine, or the harness lead. I prefer the harness lead. You may think things are going fine, and you may have misread the situation. Things might go fine for a while. They might start playing right away, and all of a sudden, you find out they have different play styles, and that causes conflict. A lot of dogs will play initially, and they go, whoa, you're too much. I don't like that, and they don't know each other, so it turns into a fight. We can never really predict how that's going to go. And, again, dog introductions with dogs who are struggling, higher level topic. If they're not struggling, though, and they're just dogs who don't have behavior issues, you should be able to go on a tandem walk, go into the yard, leave the leashes on. And the reason for that is if one dog makes a bad choice, one dog does too much and it is just, it's too much. The other dog wants to get away. Most dogs, if fight and flight kick in, as long as flight is an option, they will pick that. But instead of you then rushing in and trying to grab the dog who's just being too extra by the collar and the dog getting startled and then turning around and biting you, you just step on a leash because it's right there. So it gives you 4 to 6 feet of room and you're not putting your hands right near the bitey part of this brand new dog. So that's kind of the basic rule for introducing dogs to your home and into your home. Shannon, we have a Doberman, fostering another Doberman. How do you limit the amount of play time? Generally healthy play, but can lead to aggression from our resident dog, jealousy, resource guarding. At this point, we're visually babysitting 24/7. So Shannon, what I do is I have a lot of controlled together time where we get the initial energy out. We go for that, even if they're okay, we go for the tandem walk first, get the initial energy out of the way, put them in the yard together, and I have 3 T's that we have to remember when we're in the yard together. No treats, no toys. Some dogs can have issues over just regular toys. Again, it all depends on what they were exposed to or did or did not have access to early on, and no touch. This is the tough one. I can't tell you how many dogs have gotten into fights because someone was petting the brand new dog and loving them because, again, we feel bad for them. We feel sorry for them. They had a bad life. We're showering them with love. They haven't had this in a while. Our resident dog walks up who they've been fine with, and all of a sudden they snap. We have to kind of predict that those things might happen, or vice versa. It could be the other way around, that we're petting the resident dog. The resident dog is fine walking with this dog and fine playing with this dog, but they haven't quite gotten used to the idea that this new friend is sticking around, that this new friend isn't just a temporary playmate and this new friend now lives with us. So those initial intros might go well. Those initial tandem walks might go well. And all of a sudden, as you're trying to share affection and you want everyone to be on the couch so you can take a picture for the gram, that you have an issue. So I am also pretty vigilant, Shannon. But again, this is where crate training is a great tool. If your dog is crate trained, we put a lot of high value and long lasting treats out for our dogs so we can let them play for a little while. We don't wait for an issue, but give them some time, and it's based on them to get the all the play out of their system. And then we guide the new dog into their crate. We give them a Kong. Our freezer is stuffed with Kongs. We put peanut butter in them, and then we freeze them overnight. So they're always frozen. It takes them an hour or so. We have bully sticks. We have lots of different long-lasting things where they can have their fun, and then we can put them away so they're safely away. They're not bored. They're not on timeout. They're not whining. They're not stressed. But they're having something awesome in there. Our resident dog also gets something awesome because it can be hard. No matter how friendly your dog is, no matter how many dogs your dog can play with at the dog park or wherever, having a friend is just like kids, you know, meeting a friend and realizing that it's your new friend. It can be the greatest thing ever. And all of a sudden they're spending the night, and then they're spending another night. And then wait a second, this is your stepbrother. I didn't sign up for this. That can be hard. So give them time, be a little vigilant, but that's where crate training comes into play. Okay, you're welcome. Okay. Lauren, go for a walk. She freaks out when the dogs are around. We notice that when we run her, she's okay, but for walking, she lunges, growls, and barks. That's because there's a time lag where dogs see things and they're deciding what to do. And sometimes running straight past the trigger can be one of the ways that we can avoid that. Doesn't seem super aggressive, but it is intense. She doesn't bark or show aggression in other circumstances. We've been pulling her back and saying, leave it good, or is there a better approach? So what I would like you to try, Lauren, is some controlled training. A lot of leash walks, it's hard to control a leash walk. There's a lot of unknown variables. Dogs rushing around the corner, off-leash dogs, retractable leashes, owners not paying attention. I like to, for dogs like this where they see a dog and they freak out, I like to use the dog park as my testing ground, as my training grounds. Now, don't log off and think I'm insane right away. Just stick with me here. We don't go inside the dog park. We stay outside the dog park. We use the fence as our boundary. If every dog has a bubble, a matter of distance, where they can see a trigger and stay under threshold and stay under control of us and listen to that recall training and recall commands. If we work within that bubble and stay there for a while, like I said, whether it's people or dogs, the bubble will get smaller and smaller and smaller. So the dog park, if you have one in your area where you have an area outside the park where you can find 20, 40, 50, 100 feet, however much room you need, where you can have your clicker, have your high value rewards, have your recall training, and just walk parallel to the fence. We're not walking towards the fence. If the dogs are all over here, we're not getting any closer to them. This is backwards. We're not getting any closer to them. We're walking this way. It's see a dog, focus on me, take a reward. See a dog, focus on me, take a reward. And just stay however far away you have to be. If you do that every other day, and you don't worry so much about leash walks right now, and you then wait until you can actually go to that dog park and walk within 5 or 10 feet of the fence and get that kind of response, that's when you can take a dog out to the real world and your leash walking will go so much better. So that might be hard. That might mean you take your dog in the car and go somewhere else for a while until your dog is ready for this. But if you take some extra time in the beginning, develop these foundational recall training exercises and then practice them where you have some more control and you have some more space, then we get a dog who can perform that a little better from 5 or 10 feet away. Thank you. Foster dog doesn't want to go in the crate at all. We try to give him bully sticker con, doesn't really work. Try to lure him. No, you should never force him. You should never force him. What I would do is I would put his food in there. I would make his food more stimulating, and I would wait for him to eat in there, honestly. They typically will go in there. If they're really struggling, though, that kind of points that to me is an indication that maybe the crate was used inappropriately in the past for this poor dog. Maybe they were just jammed in there and tossed in there, and they had to stay there for 8-12 hours, or that was their punishment area. So they may have a negative association. If they have a negative association, we just got to try a little harder and be a little more patient, make things more valuable. Bully sticks and Kongs are really, really valuable. So try and find something maybe a little more smelly, maybe a little more wet. Try and, sprinkle up some anchovies, some Braunschweiger, get more valuable, get smellier, get grosser, and just be patient. Okay. This is the kind of multi-dog tips, management tips, if you will. You're welcome. We've kind of talked about a lot of this already, and we're getting into almost 2 hours here, so we're going to have to cut it off in about 15 minutes. I've had a lot of great questions. I'm loving all the questions. Please know I'm loving them all. But we're going to have to cut this off in about 13 minutes or so. So I'm going to go through this really quickly. And Katie said, Katie's going to take notes of any questions we miss. We can answer those later. We talked about this. Tolerance grows as the relationship grows. Think back to the analogy of you having someone eat food off of your plate at a restaurant and they're a stranger versus a family member. If we go slow and we manage all the resources, as they have more of an individual relationship, they will become more tolerant. The dogs that fight over toys in the beginning, if we don't allow that behavior, we don't put those thoughts in their head and we let the relationship grow, just as two dogs doing dog stuff together without these other things, those are the dogs that can share those things down the road. And again, back to the crate training, back to that 0.5 kind of window that we have. If we're just letting our dogs, do whatever and we're hoping for the best and we're not managing them and we're not controlling the resources, it's not about dominance. It's not about being the alpha. It's about being able to help them make the right choices. If we can't be there to help them make the right choices, if we can't be there, or even worse, to stop the fights before they happen, if we can't see them to redirect the behavior we don't want, we can't help them. We just can't. So if we think about it that way and think about a crate as a place where we can safely put a dog so that we can help them. And real quick, Nisha, you can also try, just so you know, you can try another controlled area. Some dogs, if they really struggle with a crate, I'm not sure what your house is like, but if you have, say, like a laundry room and the laundry room is a little bit bigger, you can potentially put the dog in the laundry room with a baby gate, still put the crate in there, put all the good stuff in the crate, take the door off, and if they're more comfortable in like a larger area where all their good stuff is still there, you can have that management, you can have that control, you can have that safety, and you can give them time on their own while you're gone to decide to go into the crate to get some good things. So that can be a way that you can kind of, if you have to leave, if you can do that in your home, that's possible, to put them in a smaller area where the crate can also sit. They might be more comfortable with that. Normal shelter dog behavior, resource guarding. If they haven't had sufficient access to a lot of resources, whether throughout their whole life or just the past couple of weeks to months that they've been sheltered, they're going to have a hard time sharing those things. Consider resource guarding normal shelter dog behavior. If you follow these tips, you should get past that between the 3 week and 3 month range. Fear-based reactivity is normal shelter dog behavior. Most aggression is fear-based. So if all we're doing is trying to stop the behavior with all we're doing is adding more fear of the situation. I don't care if it looks like it's working short term, it's not giving you the relationship you're going to need and want long term. Forgetting house training is normal shelter dog behavior. Expect your dog to forget those things. Again, that's why the feeding schedule and the crate training followed with these rules where the second they're out the crate, they're on leash at that one spot where they pee, with treats in hand, and we just wait it out and then make a massive deal out of it. That's going to help you get past those initial roadblocks that might be very, very difficult for you guys. All right. So kind of a rule of thumb I have here. We already talked about how your dogs are lacking in both physical and mental stimulation. It's not just the stress. It's not just the noise. It's not just the environment at the shelter. It's all of that combined with not enough physical stimulation, not enough mental stimulation. You are basically taking in a hot mess usually. So we have to understand that. We have to be okay with that. We have to expect that. And that's why I personally believe, this is just my own personal mantra, my personal belief with my dogs and any dog I work with that comes from a shelter. Before we have any right to expect behavior from our foster dogs, we have to ask ourselves, have we met this dog's needs first? If we've met their needs first and they're still demand barking, we can talk about that later. But if we haven't met their needs first, we have to say, not how do I stop my dog from barking, but why is my dog barking? Not how do I get my dog to stop pulling, but why is my dog pulling? And not how do I get my dog to share bones and toys, but why am I asking my dog to share those things in the first place? Is there a less stressful, safer way for them to enjoy those items without worrying about having sufficient access, without causing problems? So again, change the questions. If you're asking, how do I stop this? Change it to, why is this happening? And see if you've met your dog's needs first. There's a good chance with the shelter, through no fault of your own, that you haven't. Here are some tips, mental and physical stimulation tips. I'm not going to go into all of this. You can look at it, you can see it, you can read them. Any terms here you're not familiar with, you can Google search since we're running short on time. I want to very quickly see if there's any of these questions I can answer before I answer them by email. Mary, senior Borzoi, real skittish. That can be sometimes a little bit of genetics too with them. Nature and nurture, loves to crate, sometimes comes to socialize, still feels mostly safe in the crate, pulls so hard on the leash when we go for a walk to get back home, seems to enjoy it at first. Is it too soon for walks? Probably, Mary. Just go to the point that they no longer enjoy it. Don't go past that point and force it. If you go slow, and even if it's just hanging out in the driveway for a little bit and then going back inside, if every little baby step is positive, eventually you'll be so far past that before you know it. How do I properly introduce dogs to confident cats and skittish cats, cats in general? We will talk, make sure you save Karina's email. We'll have a little sidebar conversation because there's more to that, as well as the muzzle conditioning. We'll talk more about that. In general, if you want some muzzle conditioning tips, you can go to the Muzzle Up Project. It's a great education and advocacy website for muzzles. So you can start with the Muzzle Up Project, and we can also have a little bit more of a sidebar as well. And finally, you have a resource guarder who is a resident. Any good reads or quick tips? For this one, I'm going to send you to my friend, Debbie McMullen. Her website is How Many Dogs? www.howmanydogs.com is the website. You got that? Great, thanks. I'm sorry. So Carly, start there. It's not uncommon for us to have dogs where we've never had to think about controlling resources because they're the resident dog. And then all of a sudden this new dog comes in and they do struggle. So start with howmanydogs.com. Look at some of their tips there. It kind of comes down to the same tips for the resident dog as the foster dog. Pick everything up. There's actually a program we can follow called... it's the Sophia Yen program. Not nothing in life. Learn to Earn. Yes. So there's a program called Learn to Earn from Dr. Sophia Yen. It should be in one of those links there. If you want to have more impulse control and you want to develop better and stronger leadership with your dog, forget all the dominance alpha stuff, look at the Learn to Earn program. It can also help with managing and controlling, whether it's a resident dog or a new dog who is struggling with resource guarding. All these options here are all good options. Like I said, if you have any questions about anything here, the dog backpacks, the walkie dog, the tether tub, the dog pacer. Thank you so much, Carly. Nose work. Google barn hunts. Does your dog like sniffing? Is it annoying because they sniff all the time on walks? They like to use their nose. That's a great way to wear them out. See if you have local barn hunts. See if you have local places that do agility work. A lot of them will take a shelter dog or a foster dog for a big discount. So think about that. Find It or Easter Egg Hunts. That's something you can do in your apartment. You don't have a yard. You don't have a place to exercise. You can do that through Find It or Easter Egg Hunts. You can Google that later. Treat puzzles, slow feeders, all those things are ways to make your dog think more, make them use their brain, make them use their body, use their brain. The more they use their body, the more they use their brain, the more you're going to have a dog that has a bigger threshold. Thank you so much, Mary. The bigger the threshold is, the bigger you can get through to them. The more you can get through to them, the more you can really get the behavior you want. Thank you guys so much. I really appreciate your comments. If you are struggling, four thoughts here. First, be patient. Be more patient than you thought you had to be. Take a deep breath. It's going to be okay. We're all guessing here. We're all trying. These are dogs that everyone else has given up on. So you are doing the best you can. Thank you. Thank you for signing up, not only for this course, but for fostering. It's not going to be a perfect straight path. There's going to be some bumps in the road. There's going to be some poop to pick up. There's going to be some mistakes. We're going to misread some situations. You guys are doing the job that somebody else failed to do for this dog. So just, you know, take that. Be a little more patient. Be kind to yourself also if you make a mistake. If you are struggling, let the rescue know sooner rather than later. I'm working with a dog right now where the people did not want to tell the rescue what they were going through. And by the time the dog went back to the rescue, we now have learned bite history that is going to take months to work back from. Let them know ahead of time that you're struggling. If you have to hire a trainer, please reach out to one. If you don't know one in your area, let me know. I can help find you a trainer. Or hopefully your rescue can. If your trainer talks about having to dominate your dog and they talk about being the alpha, please, in all honesty, find a different trainer. There's the debunking the alpha theory. Some of these articles here, the first article here, chill out, a decompression article from Fosters. I actually wrote that myself. I'm the author. I wrote it like 5 years ago. It could probably be revised and updated, but it's still good to have as a resource. There's a clicker training video there from YouTube. That's from Zach George. He puts information out in a really good way. We got the muzzle advocacy and education link coming in next. Then we have the bat training. I did not say it by name, but the very concept that there is always a matter of distance and space before your dog can see a trigger and focus on you, we call that bat training or behavior adjustment training. Lots of different trainers have used it in lots of different terminology, but Grisha Stewart up in Washington, Oregon area really kind of perfected this process, and she put it all on YouTube. It's all there for you. So bat training, teaching your dog to leave it is almost as important as teaching your dog to focus on you. There's a video there for loose leash walking and a video there debunking the alpha theory. Thanks, Jonathan. Thank you, Jennifer. Yes, you guys will have access to this recording. I don't know how to do that, but we're going to end the session here and then figure out how we can upload it. I'm sure it'll be a YouTube link or something like that. So we have everyone's email address. If you found this helpful, if you think other people would find it helpful, once we have access to the recording, however we do that, we'll send you guys the link via email. And again, if you guys have any questions, Katie put my email address on there. We can do it one more time, or our website, savethemdogs.com. Thank you guys so much. Thank you very much. I really appreciate what you're doing. This is a crazy time. Hopefully this has been a little bit of a break from having to self-quarantine. Sorry you couldn't hang out in person. Maybe one of these days we can. But until then, thank you. Keep up the great work. I'm going to go ahead and shut this off now, and we will send you guys an email once we have it recorded. Take care, guys. Bye.